Oh, is that what they were?
And they didn't introduce themselves. One was called Rose and one was called Thorn, right?
Whoa. Yeah. They were talking about some sort of monster thumping around in their parents' basement.
Yeah, okay. I thought I'd covered that.
No, thank you.
And you guys are all level one, right?
Oh, definitely.
What is happening? I don't appreciate this. I'm not one bit.
Totally ready.
I'm totally ready. Make one of us.
Don't worry. I've been working on another crazy-ass character. So.
Of course you have.
I have.
So just in case I haven't made this clear, no goblins, no, like, evil characters.
Nope.
You know, I'm thoroughly restricting your creativity.
He's going to be a human fighter cleric warlock.
A night elf mohawk.
No triple classing.
Oh, okay, multi-class.
No triple classing.
Oh, no triple classing. I can get away with fighter warlock. Cleric warlock.
So that's still three.
Yeah, I know. It's an interesting character.
I think you mean an interesting stat combination that you figured out.
Actually, it's very suboptimal stats because of the way I'm trying to build the warlock, which is not normal for me. Making a melee warlock that doesn't use melee weapons or melee spells.
Would that sounds like it'd like... be an interesting story as to how you arrived at that.
Would that include things like Shillelagh, which isn't really like a melee spell, but
nope.
Helps with melee attacks?
No,
Shillelagh is a druid spell anyway.
Yeah,
but a warlock can
take
it.
The tome to get it, but no, this is the one I sent you, Ryan. He's going to be using crossbow expert in order to use ranged spells in melee. And so he's going to use
I don't think it works that way.
It does, actually. Official ruling says that the second item that says that you don't get disadvantage applies to other things than crossbows.
Yeah,
I'm still pretty sure that the spell, the requirement that you cast a ranged spell in melee, you get disadvantage, overrides it.
Oh, yeah?
At least in my games.
That's why I'm not going to use it in your games. I'm using straight-up stuff in your games. Going for crazy shit in the other ones. Anyway, he's going to use Eldritch Blast in melee. That's kind of his thing. And then he's going to have cantrips from other classes, too.
Yeah, it sounds like your other DM is kind of a pushover.
No.
It's all within the rules. I mean, besides that one time I cursed myself with an oracle, which was a terrible mistake.
You say that, but then you gave up on that guy pretty quickly.
Yeah,
I did.
Pretty
who knows
quickly.
What's gonna happen to him.
I actually when I was building this character, I was like, okay, I built it like two different ways. I said, what's the most armor I can stack on this guy? And I was like, I could go Oracle. And I said, nope, I'm not doing it. I'm not going down that path again. So. Alright, who's playing Zelda?
Sister in the background.
Oh, hello, sister.
I thought it might have been Final Fantasy.
Is it crazy audible?
It's not too bad. It's just background noise.
Okay.
It's bad enough that I'm going to punish you.
Oh, yeah.
No!
Pun damage is coming your way.
Pun damage? That's the worst kind.
Oh, nice. The goodies. Ooh.
Getting all sorts of shit, isn't it?
to get a shareable link. Yep.
So is the sister that's playing in the background Amanda's twin sister?
Well, we're not. No, we're years apart.
So yes.
So yes.
The one that looks so much like her that they thought they could pass it off on a date.
Don't worry about it, Ben. Okay.
Yep, the same one.
It worked out great.
I know it finally worked out for you, but the. The chutzpah of trying to pull it off was just, it's epic. I mean,
this is life.
Oh, that's right. I almost died.
And basically, that's like a most interesting man in the world sort of event.
This is how we roll.
I can see it.
Gotta keep things interesting.
He once arranged a date and had his date's sister show. He is the most interesting man in the world. Okay, well, Chip said he might be a little bit late. But I see a Lucas and a Zen. Amanda theoretically is around here somewhere.
Hey, I'll show up on one of the days. No problem.
Now I can just go and smack her.
This is the part where I open it up to the... page in the book that tells me how you guys are going to die tonight.
That's fantastic. After last week, we might deserve it. At least Chesco and I.
At least Chesco. I won't argue with you.
Oh my gosh. I watched that video so many times on Wednesday. My face was hurting all day.
Is that from facepalming yourself so many times, or
just laughing? Just I played the same like 3 second clip of Chesco going, "It just got really out of hand." I almost got.
We showed my sister today, and she cracked up laughing. We're like, "Yes, perfect."
I showed my wife, and she's like, "I have no idea what the hell you're doing."
She probably didn't laugh, did she?
No.
Yeah.
She's like, I've got better things to do.
That's about what my wife says.
Really?
What?
Oh, that's nice. Okay, now I've got these other things to do. That's nice, sweetie. Go play your games with your dice.
Mm-hmm. Pretty much.
Oh, goodness.
I mean, she's still the best wife ever, but yeah.
Aren't they all?
That's pretty much her outlook on D&D.
My wife has a stipulation. She says, on Sundays, you're not allowed to talk about your game. At all. Like, that's what I'm thinking about it. Okay.
Sundays is our game day.
I know. She said, you know, once you go into the office, then that's fine. Any other time during the week, go ahead and talk to me about it. Not on Sunday.
Basically, what she's saying is she's pissed at your gaming on Sunday, so don't talk to her about it, or she's going to get mad at you.
Exactly.
That seems like a really effective relationship you've worked out there.
As long as it works.
It does.
Whatever it takes to play D&D, guys. I mean, Chesco's going to have to quit his job, so...
It's clearly been interfering too much.
Clearly.
Yep.
I'm not going to have my sneaky buddy this week.
That's probably good for everyone.
Did he say he just wasn't coming, or is it if he was going
to
be late?
He said he had to work late. Oh. So, I assume that meant not coming. And Adam said he's not coming. Yeah. Because he hates everyone and everything.
Oh, no. They just... I thought they were supposed to alternate weeks. What the heck?
I know. I tried. It's like I was going to roll it into, you know, a single character. It's going to be Caden Chesko, the Wiz Ranger.
Wiz Ranger. The Rangeard.
We have an extra sister if you guys need one.
No, I've got one sister. That's enough. I mean, if you have an extra player, that's different.
She can try. I can't guarantee they'll live, but, you know, it's their own fault for not making it.
Yeah, that's probably true.
Well, I mean, in fairness, we've got assassins coming after us anyway, so we're probably not going to live anyway.
We don't know that.
I mean, it's funny you say we. I mean, I don't think I have any assassins coming after me.
You will when they find out you're in the city.
But I'm not in the city. I specifically stayed out of the city.
He was very out of this.
I was just nearby. I don't know you, sir. Please stop speaking with me.
Okay. Well, who wants to give the recap?
Lucas does.
No, I'll give it.
We've already determined.
Let's get started.
All right. Well, I believe, if I remember correctly, we started last week in the tent. Right? Yeah. I think we started in the tent. And then we decided on how we were going to get information based on what I saw the week previously. And so we deliberated, and Numa wasn't sure when he was supposed to go, you know, if he was going to go somewhere and how long he was going to be gone based on the caravan owner, or not the caravan owner, but one of the merchants that was traveling through. And then we decided that Chesko and I would go out and try to gather more information to see what this cult was doing and possibly infiltrate them. We went to where I thought they were, knocked on the door, and we said Dragon Cult. Or actually, I said Dragon Cult. And he didn't like that very much. So Chesko decided to start proclaring his love for Tiamat. In the streets, got himself in trouble with the guards. Now they think he's, you know, not all there in the brain. And then we decided to head back to the group because we didn't get any information. And then we were followed, went into a bar, tried to interrogate the guy. He wasn't giving up anything. So we said, you know what? We'll take him out back. And then his friends came up and we're like, well, okay, this is great. And then they said they were going to go take us to have a civilized conversation. And we duped it out and they attacked us. We duped it out in the alleyway. Chesko almost died. I almost died. Came down to one die roll. And then we hobbled back. And then we had the 15 minutes of laughter.
I'm pretty sure looking back at it, I could have killed you. I missed some opportunities.
Oh no, you definitely could have.
Could have or should have?
Possibly both.
So, I think...
I think there was one round I forgot to attack twice. Some things could have been different.
Oh, that's right. He had multi-attack and we were duking it out. Yeah. I probably would have died. Yeah, fair enough.
I mean, to be fair, if you want, you can go ahead and get those couple of attacks in now.
Right now.
As a couple passerbys just hurl rocks at him.
I just pass out from great wounds I didn't know I had right in front of everybody. Keel on the floor.
Ooh, natural 20.
Nice.
All right, so please, we got two dead characters in the
good,
party.
Oh, good.
8 more damage.
Okay. That puts me at... Okay, so the wounds go up, right? For HP?
Yes.
Wounds? Okay.
Yeah. But this was before any healing.
Right. That probably would have put me unconscious. In the alleyway.
Well, you know, and we both at the end of the day, it's probably okay, because you forgot you could heal yourself, too, so.
Better luck next time.
I still got to, put a sticky note on my desk or something for that, because I don't remember in combat hit dice healing
thing. Yeah, I added it, right under my attacks, so I remember.
Okay. So, you guys have made it back. You began sharing all the information you had. You had discovered during your adventure, and Aiken had
Celebon,
Cinnabon. Cinnabon man had kind of given you what he could make out about the situation you found yourselves in, and you had discovered that you're really not necessarily any closer to knowing what the heck is going on with the cultists.
We did find out that the house Xander is the Thieves Guild in Boulder's Gate. And that's apparently who we ran into.
That is also true.
Maybe.
No, I'm pretty sure. I'm pretty sure that was them.
So, I believe you left off basically debating what to do on the morrow, since this was getting on towards evening by the time you guys made it back. Mm-hmm. So what are your plans? What would you guys like to do? And is Octavia ever going to join us?
Hey, I hung out with everyone else while selected members killed innocent beings, okay? Maybe it's smart for me to stay back.
In fantasy grounds.
Yeah, fantasy grounds. You're not logged in.
No.
What?
Sorry. I'm sorry, guys.
Ryan, how much is she drinking?
I don't know, because she's in another room right now.
Sounds like a lot.
Sounds like a
lot. I had to go to the same room. Aww. Just to watch over her.
Here's another really drink. Here's another drink. It's fun.
Okay, Amanda, this is Fantasy Grounds. If you want to double click this icon. Yeah.
Clearly, I'm a terrible multitasker, guys. Okay.
I thought you were seeing.
Well, if one of the tasks is drinking, I think everyone's a terrible multitasker.
I'm about halfway through my first.
Well, I've had more than you, I can say that.
Oh.
Yeah, you can see how this is just not going to go well.
Oh, jeez.
Sounds like a solo adventure for Octavia back into the alleys of
Boulder's Gate. We got this. Don't get distracted.
Okay, so what do you guys want to do?
Well,
do you believe any of these assassins were following you out of the gates?
I do not believe so.
Do we have any sort of cause for concern regarding these threats made against you?
Not until they find the bodies.
It sounds like we are going to have to move even faster than originally intended.
I don't know if they'll be able to pin it on Chesco and I, but I mean, it is what it is.
But whoever would have sent those men after you surely would be aware of your faces at the very least.
Yeah, most likely.
I feel like that's very reasonable to assume. So I suppose it'd be best if we move out with the caravan whenever they decide to leave. I mean, most of us have positions that are hiring.
I believe Numa said that he was looking for or going to talk to Simmerdag. Simmerdag. Simmerdag?
Yeah. Yep. Numa and Chesco both pipe up and say that they're pretty sure they have a spot working for Simmerdag as guards. They just need to find out when he plans on leaving.
Similar story goes for myself and one more in our party. I've gained employment with, I believe her name was Imsa, the green-skinned woman.
And Caden pipes up and says, she sounds interesting. Perhaps I will work with you.
Very well. That leaves two of us without employment currently.
Well, Octavia, you want to see if we can find some work?
I suppose that's what we have to do. Get out of here alive.
Is Celebon with us at the moment?
He is.
Mr. Celebon, do you know if there's any other patrons looking for guards on the trip north?
I do not know if there is a specific merchant looking for guards, but as I told your friends, if you make your way to the taverns and watering holes, as it were, of the Black Gate, I'm sure you will find those who are seeking employment as guards and those who are hiring.
Well, it sounds like we need to make a trip to the tavern.
Well, then let's go to the tavern, shall we?
Sure. All right.
Caden, you can follow me so we can meet with the Lady Imsa.
And he happily follows along.
And we're off to see the tavern.
We're off to see the wizard. The wonderful wizard of the tavern.
You guys, walk in, and I need you each to make perception checks.
Oh, they didn't even roll.
Good on mine.
No, it just kind of dropped, and then
the random number generator just dropped a number.
Drop the beat.
Damn it.
So, Octavia, as you take a look around the tavern, you take in that most of the people here seem to be either caravan guards or merchants, and you spot someone that looks like they pretty well know what's going on. You see a human female who looks to be outfitted as though she were used to working for a living and having to do her own fighting.
I will walk up to her. She looks like a promising person to walk up to. Good, is it morning, afternoon, or evening right now?
It's evening.
Good evening. And I'll kind of, like, bow my head a little bit and...
Yes?
Kind of wave the bartender over.
Good evening to you as well. May I help you with something?
I couldn't help but notice. You just seem to know a little bit... You just appear like you know what's going on around here, and... I've just gotten here. It's basically my first day in this overwhelming city, and I'm looking for work. My friend and I am gonna like usher over towards him.
I will walk over because she can't remember my name.
I was like, I couldn't remember which one came with me.
And the lady starts to laugh. She says, "Yes. I can see it about you. You do look new.
Clearly.
Let me introduce myself. My name is Lida. And who might you be?
My name is Octavia. Thank you for asking. And this, like I said, is my friend Xavier. He doesn't talk much. I can look at him after his events of earlier today.
And
not allowed to talk much.
She seems to glance you both, give you both a quick glance, and she says, "Well, friend Octavia, you seem to have the accoutrements of a woman who knows her way about a battlefield, and your friend seems to have recently been on one. Is there something that I can do for you?"
Well, as I said before, you seem to know a little bit of... You look as though you know this area pretty well, and I was just wondering if you happen to know anyone who may be hiring on this next caravan out. We're looking for work. I mean, we're just passing through, but it'd be better if we could pass through while making something of ourselves, if you know what I'm saying.
Is this your first time at working as a caravan guard?
I've done some work in the past. I don't think it's been as... It's been very informal work, but I have definitely done my fair share of work on a battlefield. And I'm very good with guarding people with my life.
Well, you've come to the right person, then. You see, I am a guard and a mercenary. Have been for years. I spent most of my time down south, and while I do not know Baldur's Gate particularly well, I have been in 100 places just like this. And I, too, am bound on the next caravan heading north, which I must assume is where you wish to go if you're looking for work here.
Yes. You are correct.
Well, perhaps if you were to give me some sort of demonstration of what you are actually capable of, I would be willing to put a word in with you with my employer. I believe he is still looking to hire a few more guards.
Well, to be honest, I'm very good with fighting, but my specialty lies in healing. If you would like for me to demonstrate, I'm sure my friend here would have no problem with that. Does he still look pretty beat up? Like, or did he heal him all the way?
Yeah, he's at like half health. He definitely looks pretty beat up.
I won't beat him then.
I'll pull up my sleeve and show like a wound.
You say you're a healer. It is most fortunate. It's always good to have a healer travel along with a group.
I like and things.
Certainly, your friend seems to be in need of healing. I would question why you haven't healed him before now, but if that is a demonstration you wish to make, please go ahead.
Let me make sure. Yes, I do. Okay, I will reach for his arm.
Would you mind waiting 8 hours?
I don't know if I can target him. Can I target him outside of combat? Yeah.
Control. You can heal him whenever.
You can. Yeah, on the combat tracker. Wait.
You got Cheska targeted too.
Sham.
Okay, well, you rolled it twice.
Did I?
Yeah.
Well, one time wasn't on him, but look at that, same numbers. What are the chances?
I think it's because you targeted both of them.
Yeah, you targeted him and Cheska.
I don't remember targeting Cheska.
Well, it's in the combat.
And the,
that was my bad. That was my bad. Cheska didn't earn it.
I'll take 17.
I just want to remind you that Prayer of Healing is a 10-minute cast.
Damn it, I forget about that every time.
Oh, God.
I had to learn the hard way.
Right. I'm back to 18 on my wounds.
Yeah, take away that. That's
you haven't actually been healed yet.
Sorry, I forget that one every time. I need to, like, put a note 10 minutes right next to it. Healing word is touch.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Healing word is cure wounds is touch.
Cure wounds. I'm gonna do cure wounds on him. That's the one I'm looking for. There we go. Oh fuck.
I go.
Damn it.
Business as usual.
And... Right, that's so much better with the 10-minute prayer one. Can we just do that one for 10 minutes?
I'll pay you to bring me with you, please.
Bring me with you.
Shit.
And
does that Lita looks and heal?
You, she, as you lay your hands upon his arm. There are not too many wounds on his arms itself. Most of them were more directed at his torso. But I want to give you the benefit of the doubt and say that Xavier was kind of like lifting up the side of his tunic so you could kind of see one of the...
Yeah, we could do that.
One of the more significant wounds. And as you lay your hands upon the wound and begin a short prayer, he kind of winces. As you take your hand away, you can already see that the wound is scarring over, and it has knit part of itself back together. He still has several other wounds that could use attention, but he has at least clearly demonstrated your ability to heal that which is very difficult to heal.
Yeah,
and
that's decent enough.
And if you want to give me a performance check. We'll see how well you sold it.
Oh dear.
Octavia or me?
Octavia.
Okay.
I feel magical again.
So, you can't manage to quite keep the disappointment in your in the healing that was done out of your face, and she seems to take notice of that, but. Indeed, I can see the wounds binding. As I said, having a healer along is a most helpful skill. I will be happy to speak to my employer about you and about the opportunities that you seek. Now you, friend, who have received such grievous wounds, do you also claim to be a guard?
Yes, I have done guard duties in times past.
And she kind of gives you a skeptical look. And what about your skills make you worth hiring?
Oh god, what skills do I want to use? Probably lying.
Have you heard about the dead bodies?
You should have seen the other guys.
There were 12 of them in an alley. I'm quite good with a rapier.
Indeed.
Obviously, I've taken some boons, but I dish out far more.
Well, come then.
Oh god. Okay.
Oh god.
And she leads you outside.
I'm gonna follow them outside. And on the way, as she like walks away, I'm gonna heal him another time if I can find the right tab to click on.
The one that says spell or actions.
Huh? Yeah.
The one that says actions.
Yeah, you know, that's the one she should have seen. But you know. As he begins to walk away, I'll heal him again.
Which is not looking, you'll do the powerful.
Right, yeah.
cracking my back a little bit.
So what you're saying is, like, as she walks off and he turns to leave, you give him a little pat on the butt. Go get him, Tiger.
Exactly, and all of a sudden he feels rejuvenated.
She's feeling something, all right.
She's like that superhero who's like, I can turn invisible as long as nobody's looking.
Yeah.
Just don't look. I can heal you if you don't look.
I don't like the pressure.
She's heel shy.
So, she walks you outside, and there are two sticks that she finds. They're basically, it's like broomstick type things that are kind of tossed over in the mud and junk beside the tavern. You figure it's probably just the broken handles of broomsticks that were tossed outside at some point.
Yeah.
And she picks them up and hands you one. She holds the other. That you claim to be good with a blade? Let us see it.
So I'll do a small little flurry and swipe it around and get used to it and just show off my fencing skills.
Okay.
Hand up.
Make sure you do the little, like, jump and skip thing with your feet.
Oh, I'm on the balls of my feet now that I've got, you know, not almost dead.
Are you proficient with broom handles?
No.
Uh-oh.
This is all right. I got this.
Are you proficient with improvised weapons?
Nope.
Yeah, okay. Anyway. So, you take the broom handle and do your flourish and everything, and she just kind of sits there watching you, taking up a very relaxed and clearly competent stance.
Does she pull out a pistol and shoot me?
She does not.
Good.
So you got that going for you.
Yay. So she's not Indiana Jones.
Yes. Okay. And
she basically just stands there waiting for you to do something.
This probably gonna bite me in the ass. Ladies first.
And she just kind of smiles and takes a couple of very quick steps towards you and faints just to see what you do. Does it make me a perception check?
Certainly.
Or actually, hold on. What would be the most appropriate for a combat like this?
Insight?
Either insight. Do an insight check.
I mean, that's judging body language, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I did it outside. Oh!
And you have no trouble seeing, like, reading her movements and anticipating them. As she faints, you step back, continuing to stay on guard.
Totally
not revealing any openings.
Yeah. So, I'll do the dance around her faint, and then I'll bring in a light jab.
Okay. Go ahead and make an attack roll, then.
Alright. Do you want me to just use the rapier?
Yeah.
Alright. Damn. It is a stick.
Yeah, and she's prepared for it and swats it aside. And she returns the attack. Sees if she can whap you across the knuckles. Does a 23 hit.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Just barely. So
she's proficient she brings in broom handles.
She brings the swing down and smacks you on the knuckles and just continues to smile and takes up her position again.
She's a broom maker. Careful.
I don't even have any. I was going to say I could cantrip her. But... Alright, we'll play the dance again. I'll look for another opening and.
And she's clearly not trying to injure you or anything. Oh, she's just testing your abilities.
Oh, yeah. So I'll go ahead and go for another Pokey Poke. 20.
And this time, as you, kind of shake your one hand, with that distraction, you actually switch you've swapped the handle over to your opposite hand. And like, And while you're doing that, you start a lunge in case they're just slightly off guard. You actually score a touch. And she kind of laughs and says, I see, a tricky one. And then she attacks again. And this time, she overextends and you step out of the way and she's slightly off balance. You can attack with advantage.
Ooh, I will. I was just going to say, I was going to try to dip behind her and do the hide action as my bonus, but I'll take advantage. Oh, 18.
And as she's overextended, you manage to whip the broom handle around and kind of smack her right across the butt. And
big smile.
She once again laughs. Says, you are pretty good. I'll grant you that. I could see your use as a guard.
I also will go have excellent eyesight and archery abilities.
Well, I won't ask you to demonstrate those. You've shown me enough. I will go talk to Asfelro and see what he says. But I think I can get you two on.
Deep, deep bow.
And as soon as you bow, she takes the stick and kind of wraps you lightly on top of the head. Says, you shouldn't give up so quickly. You never know when your opponent is playing with you. And then she just smiles and goes on inside.
She stabbed my lady.
Kidneys.
She stabbed with a broken broom handle. God,
that's right. She takes over here. Yeah! And you die. Instant death. Death by broom.
Don't worry, I can heal you.
You know what? I would take that. I would take death by broom handle in D&D.
I'll remember that.
You know what? I've died by worse things in your game, so it's all right.
Like cliffs? So,
I didn't die. Oh yeah, I did there. Yeah. It was a bridge, actually, right? The underside of the bridge that got me.
All right. Sorry, I misspoke. She's not going to talk to Les Fairlow. That's a different guy. She is going to be going to talk to Owen Evermore, or okay. Evan Moore.
Did she make it seem like she wanted us to follow, or that she was just going to get back
to She said she was going to go talk to get to her employer.
Okay.
She said she felt confident that she could get you guys hired on.
Does that name, like, ring a bell? I don't think it really does, but...
I don't really know anybody here.
You can make me a history check.
Nope. I am not the smart one.
Even with a 19, you've never heard of this guy before.
Hmm. Perfect.
Octavia,
no.
Could you use a drink?
I was about to suggest the same thing. All that ham has got me more than full, but I think something to wash it down will be more than reasonable.
Considering my evening, I might need two.
Let's make it three and call it even. I usher him inside.
I make sure that Octavia's buying, because I'm not buying three drinks.
This guy.
I'm a gentleman. So, I'm not that much of a gentleman.
Trying to talk Octavia into buying drinks. That's impressive.
You know, there's lots of guys in this bar. I probably get my own drinks for free.
I probably
could too. Oh my god. Okay. Yeah, I'm gonna look for someone who's sloshed and not holding their cup, and I'll mage hand the cup over to me.
Okay, make me a. It's a stealth or a sleight of hand roll.
Probably sleight of hand, I think.
Yeah, sleight of hand, probably.
Open or in the tower?
Yeah, just...
Ha! 22.
Ha!
So, as you walk in, you do see someone who, even though it's fairly early in the evening, has obviously been there for quite some time. And as you walk by his table, you see that his drink's still mostly full. And just as you walk by, without actually reaching for the table, your mage hand takes the cup and just walks it right next to you until you sit down at your table, and then it sits it right next to you.
I grab it and slide it over to Octavia and say, the first one's on me.
No, oh, you're too kind.
And I'll signal the to bring us more drinks.
And I'll look around and say, where's yours?
It's coming.
I'll just nod with it and start drinking. Is it a terrible drink? Does this guy have any good taste in drinks?
It's sure it's got backwash. Just beer.
Okay, I can drink that.
It's basically like the standard drink of the tavern.
Making sure it's not like mop water or something, you know?
No, this is not a contest to see who can withstand the most foul drink for the longest.
We need Chesco.
Okay.
And after a few minutes, you see Lita. You see Lita walk back across the tavern. You can kind of see the table she had come from. And over there you see a human male. Seems to be relatively well-dressed, but he has just this ridiculously gaudy hat on. Like, this hat is... Think like Flavor Flav pimp hat,
big
but
fuzzy.
With like exotic bird feathers.
Oh my god, big old pimp hat, great.
And
my kind of guy.
That's the table she comes from. She says, Owen has agreed that he could use two more guards. I've gotten you hired at standard wages. It'll be 5 gold per 10 day. And, of course, meals will be provided. Of course, the standard contract applies. If you fail to protect the wagons, or you desert, you can receive no payment. Your payment will be made in full at the end of the trip. Your employer is traveling towards Waterdeep. Beyond that point, you will need to find further employment, unless you wish to make the return trip with him. Are these terms satisfactory?
This sounds excellent. Everything we were looking for.
What will we be escorting?
Well, and she points over to the table. Do you see the man in the hat?
Yes, it's a
very... It's kind of hard to miss, yes.
Yes, indeed it is. Well, he has, he hauls birds, exotic birds, in fact the same that supplied the feathers for his exaggerated hat. And he is taking them north towards Waterdeep, where he believes there is a thriving market for these exotic birds. He's a stubborn man and as argumentative as any man I've ever known. But he's good-natured. Seems to enjoy the argument more than anything else. So.
Lita, was it?
Yes.
I suggest that when we do decide to head out with the caravan, my other compatriots here, they are guarding other wagons. We might want to stay close to them because you might be able to get some free guarding in, if need be.
This must be your first time. Yes, while your responsibility is primarily towards your immediate employer, you're expected to guard the caravan as a whole. We don't let individual members of the caravan straggle and be picked off one by one. Everyone guards the caravan as a whole, and everyone provides their fair share of guards. That's just how it works.
Understood.
You two will be reporting to me. I will be heading up our contingent of guardsmen. So, if you have questions, bring them to me. I'll be giving you your orders when the time comes.
Do you know about when this caravan will be setting off?
Well, based on the number of merchants that have come through recently looking for guards, I would say that sometime in the next 3 or 4 days we should be on our way. Usually you can count on at least 10, 12, even 15 wagons to come together to make the trek.
So tonight, you wouldn't mind joining us for a drink or two then? And I'll kind of usher over to the seats next to us.
Of course not. We're going to be working together. We should get to know each other.
My thoughts exactly. Should.
And since I know you're keen to make a good impression, I'll let you buy the first round.
Xavier was thinking the same thing. First round's on him.
Of course. Well, what do you prefer to drink?
Ale.
My kind of lady. I'll get you a drink right now. I'll go up and go to the bartender and get 3 ales.
I'll finish the first drink that I have.
And you had no trouble procuring your ales and making your way back to your table.
So tell us, Lydia, what brings you to Baldur's Gate?
Well, I worked as a mercenary and as a caravan guard for 18 years now. Most of that time I spent in the hot deserts of Kalimshan. I decided that I was sick and tired of the heat and the grit and the sand and the smell. And Kalimshan is, well, it's an interesting place.
I've not heard of it.
She is. You've never heard of Kalimshan? The great empire to the south.
Can I do a history check to know if I've heard of it? Because Amanda yes. hasn't heard of it.
You can absolutely do a history check. You have definitely heard of Kalimshan.
Oh, I heard you wrong. I thought you said Kalimshan. Kalimshan. Yes.
I think really you need different. Another drink, Octavia.
This is a very interesting society, to say the least.
What you know of Kalimshan is that it is far to the south. Technically, I guess Kalimshan is kind of the capital city of the Empire. But I think the Empire is like the Empire of Kalimshan or something along those lines. Let me double check. Make me do my homework properly.
Oh, goodness.
That's what history checks do.
It is what history checks do. Okay. Then you can step in any time here if you remember.
And like I said, I've never heard of it. Sorry.
I know very little more than it's like a desert city.
Yeah.
Or that might even be Kalimport.
I may be thinking of Kalimport too. I may have said it wrong.
We know it's a desert city, that's all.
City, very far in the south. We got slaves and stuff.
Oh, good. Someone's going to make dinner.
Yep. Oh. Oh. Speaking of making delicious foods.
Don't talk about it. I tried to make brownie cookies today, and it turned out terrible.
Allie brings me sausage balls.
Giggity. I told my mom that we're going to send you a box to fill with food for us.
Isn't that
Amanda
so nice
said she's
of her?
Mailing you a box that she expects you to fill with food and send back.
Hello, Ellie.
She said hello, Ellie.
She knows my name.
You've got a foot in the door.
So exciting.
At least she knows your name. She knows me as the crazy one.
You're just a bed talk, okay? More than I've gotten.
Oh. As far as you know.
Oh.
Oh.
I do love her.
Anyway, she's from the south. It's a desert empire. Think like, you know, Middle Ages Arabian Empire.
Ah.
Slaves, tents.
Have you seen camels before?
Oh, those cursed beasts.
I hear that they have humps on their backs, like horses, yet bigger and funny-faced with humps.
Oh, that they certainly do.
They sound very interesting.
And they spit.
They spit.
They're stubborn. They stink. They spit. Just, suffice to say, I was sick and tired of the Empire and its peoples, and I was ready for something different. So I thought, what better than to go to the north and feel what it's like to truly experience a cold winter?
Oh, it can be very cold.
And trust me, the south can be very hot. It would take an extremely cold winter for me to shake the scorch and burns of that blasted desert place.
I'm not sure about that. Sometimes it just takes a slight breeze.
Well, I look forward to it nonetheless.
Well, heading north will definitely get you there, I assure you. I've traveled quite often in my short time here, but it's been very eventful.
And what about you? Where are you from? What brings you to Baldur's Gate, and why have you chosen to take up the profession of a caravan guard?
Well,
you obviously must be... Well, I've never known a healer who wasn't a cleric of some kind. Obviously been blessed by the gods.
As you know, I am a healer. And really, I left my small town village with my adopted parents just to help, because I realized how short life can be, and I just wanted to prolong it for people as long as possible. They showed me great kindness by adopting me into their home, and as they were growing older, I realized that I could do more than just help them on their farm. So I set out, and I found a few friends along the way, and here I am today, just going through trying to be as useful as can be, being a healer.
So
sometimes, you know.
You say that you were adopted, so some sort of orphan, then?
Yes. It was... It was a long time ago.
Oh, sorry, time out.
Where would Zave here be from? Probably a wooded area somewhere.
I don't remember my hometown at all.
I didn't pick one.
I don't think I picked one either.
Mine was
destroyed. I haven't read my background in a long time. All I know is that I have people who took me in. So I might as well be adopted. I don't have the papers for it, though, so I don't know if it counts.
It's unofficial. Destroyed, so. I'm thinking the forest sounds good. That sounds unicorny. Unicorny. Wood elf. I read Unicorn Run, and I was like, that sounds unicorny.
Xavier's from the Unicorn Land.
You were taken in, adopted, became a healer, wanted to preserve people's lives, and then as your adopted parents who brought you in and raised you were getting old, you ran off. Is that what I'm catching?
I didn't run off. They sort of sent me off. They took me in to heal me in a way, and made me stronger, because when they found me, I was a scrawny little thing. I was nothing more than skin and bones. And when they took me in and took care of me, I realized that I could do that for people as they did for me, and that is what they wanted for me. I was never intended to be a long-term child, but they took care of me as long as they could afford, and they sent me on my way to take care of the world as they took care of me.
I see. Well, at least it's because, no, you're not heartless.
I try not to be. But don't we all? And I'll hold up my glass.
And she kind of smiles and then takes a drink. And she looks over at Xavier. And what of you? What brings you to the guarding profession?
Well, I used to be a dungeon delver of sorts. Many years ago. I used to set out in front of adventurers and remove traps from ancient keeps and those kind of dark places.
That seems like an unusual trade. Most adventuring bands I've known have their own people to take care of such things for them.
Yes, but where I come from, my former clan were the best around. And we've trained for thousands of years in the arts of dungeon delving and removal of traps.
Well, you must not have been very good at it if you've taken thousands of years to haven't removed them all yet.
Well, you only get paid for so many.
Ah.
If you can do something well, get money for it.
I couldn't agree more. That's why I've always been a mercenary. I was good at one thing growing up, and that was beating up boys and, well, everyone else. And,
Amen to that.
I scratch my head a little bit. I understand.
Well, now that we've gotten that out of the way. And she gets up and leaves.
That was a lovely chat, Xavier. Very proud we didn't kill anyone.
I tried to talk as little as possible because you told me not to talk.
You did well. You did well. I think that's what probably saved us. I heard how things got out of hand yesterday, and I just don't want to repeat.
I did not say much. That was mostly Chesco.
Ah. So,
so you guys continue drinking, have, you know, kind of relaxed for the evening, and realize that you have successfully acquired employment for all six members of your party. Hopefully all on the same caravan heading north.
Hopefully. We don't know yet. I mean, Numa and Chesco don't even know where they're going, how long they're going to be gone. They're just like, yeah, sure.
These are doing very true things.
Yeah. Money? Sure.
We're not here to find out, either.
No, we're not. Just kicking some plates.
So I suppose we'll finish drinking and head back to camp.
Alright.
Yes, I need to rest for the night.
How many drinks are you guys having?
And three.
I'm gonna have just the one.
Aravan's taking it just one, too. Only during the introductions between the Green Woman and Caden.
Okay. I need each of you to deduct the cost of at least one ale from your gold supply.
Is that like a gold piece?
I want to say it's like 3 silver for an ale.
Oh, is that in the PHP?
What is this, extortion?
There's like common living expenses.
Well, all I'm saying is I got 2 free.
Ale.
You got 1 for free.
4 copper pieces for a mug.
I got 2 for free because he stole 1 for me, he bought 1 for me, and I bought the 3rd. Haha.
So I owe you...
I'm just saying someone paid for it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I
owe you a silver and 2 copper.
Okay. That works.
Isn't living expenses in the front of it?
No, it's behind the horses items. And things.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll get you the exact page if I can find it again. The food and drink is on page 158. And then living expenses on 157.
I was so close to being there.
Yeah, I mean, I figure a modest lifestyle. So that includes like clothes and things like that. So just for food.
Yeah, I think food is on that other one too. 158.
Yeah, there you go. An inn stay. A modest inn would cost you 5 silver pieces a day. Okay. So if you go on a drinking binge, it'd probably be
gold for the night.
Yeah. Okay.
So it's 3 silver for a drink?
No, 4
copper. No, it's 4 copper.
All right.
Unless you want to get into the wines and the spirits. But just a mug of ale is 4 copper. Like a
human ale's fine.
I'm going to kick my habit right now of wine. 2 silver pieces for a pitcher. 10 gold pieces for a bottle. Man, what do they think? They're rich?
Do you like luxury?
That's when I have to start employing the age-old tradition of five-finger discounts on people's coin purses to start paying for my own food.
Jesus.
Hey, gotta live.
So, you guys get back to the inn, or not the inn, the tent, and you kind of all gather around for the evening, and you start discussing how you're going to, with all the information that Chesco and Xavier were able to gather, how you're going to put it all together and track the cultists before you have to head out or cancel your employment contracts.
Yes.
I just made mine. I don't have the tent.
Numa's still writing that letter from all day.
Yeah. It's very long. He didn't really understand the ciphers, so he keeps writing it wrong in cipher. He's gone through at least half a ream of paper.
Oh, goodness.
Numa, who's buying all this paper?
Don't worry, it's coming out of his funds. So, I suppose we should get a good night's rest, and then in the morning we'll discuss how to proceed on finding more information about the cult.
Well, as long as we actually get information this time, I think that's a good plan.
I agree.
Everybody would like to take this opportunity to make sure that everyone's caravans are scheduled to leave at the same time. Like, to make sure people aren't, like, supposed to leave tomorrow.
Okay.
So, and I'll say 3 or 4 days for Octavius and myself.
And you basically go to, you convince your party members to each go back to their employer and ask when they plan on leaving. And all of them give the same answer. Whenever the caravan... Whenever we have enough to make the caravan, we plan to head north. And there's no fixed date.
Okay. Noma, this is the sort of information you want to take down when you agree to guard the caravan. For future reference, keep this in mind.
And Numa just kind of says, okay, yeah, if you say so.
Now we sleep.
All right. Are you posting any watches?
I'll take first watch.
I'll take the last 4 hours after my trance.
And I'll take the 2 hours before his 4.
Okay.
Oh, that's right. We're elves. We can do the 4 and 4 thing and it'd be good.
Yeah, buddy.
Okay, guys, not everyone's that special.
So is it still going to be Octavia and then, you know, elf then elf?
Yeah.
Okay.
She's going to feel like...
Quiet, round ears.
All right, well, if... Octavia, if you will make me a D20 roll in the tower.
Oh god, assassins in the night. Assassins in the night.
Dun dun
dun. So you stay up gnawing on your ham bone and you're it's kind of a nervous tick because you're concerned about these whole like this thieves guild and the fact that they tried to kill 2 members of your party and you don't really know what's going on. And eventually your 2 hours pass and the best of your ability, you have not seen or heard anything that might indicate someone was coming.
I will wake up Erevan. It's time for your watch, Erevan, if you don't mind. I'm very tired.
I'll sleep well, then.
I will nod and put my hand bone back on the table before heading to bed.
And,
I'm sleeping with Erevan in my hand, by the way.
If you will make me a D20 check of the tower.
Yes, sir. Didn't fall on the tower.
Yeah. Don't you hate that?
There we go.
Silly tower.
It drops it right next to it. I'm like, come on.
Alrighty. So, as you take up your watch, you decide that maybe sitting inside the tent is not the best place to be. You actually get up and kind of wander the business area where Akin Celeban does his trade. And it's while you're outside and with your elf heritage enhancing your vision that you see a palanquin make its way through the gate and up the road.
Into the city or out of the city?
Out of the city.
Out of the city. Oh, man. I would like to first make sure that I am looking like a human using the hat of disguise.
Okay.
Not like my old self. And then I would like to go back for my party as quick as I can.
No. I described the other palanquin, right? Yeah, I did.
You did.
Okay.
From the distance that he's seeing this, Erevan, you can't actually identify. All you do is you see a palanquin come out.
Okay. In that case, I would like to kind of press closer.
Okay.
Not the palanquin.
No, just a palanquin.
Okay. I don't want to try and tail it too far because I know, me being myself, I'm not very great at stealth.
Well, it actually hasn't even reached where you are.
Okay, so I could just kind of wait up by the roadside and hope it passes by.
Yeah, from where you're standing, you can see the thing being carried and making its way down the road.
All right. So I'll just kind of hang out, lean up against whatever I'm nearby. Give a nod to the guys as they walk by and try my best to kind of like peer through the little curtains as it goes. Okay.
So that's your plan?
That's my plan, yeah.
Okay. So, I need a performance check to see how nonchalant and casual you managed to pull this off.
Oh, he's totally got to be the Marlboro man.
Super chalant.
All right. So, you take up a pose that to any passerby would look like slightly drunk hanging on to the fence to support himself. and you kind of lean there, and the palanquin, you can see making its way up the road, turns off and stops in front of a different yard. This one having lots of horses. You know that Akin is not the only dealer in goods and wares for people setting out on caravans.
Do they look to have like torches lit? Effectively, like, are the lights on? Like, they look like they're still in business, or would this be more like after hours kind of a deal?
The reason you've taken notice is that it's been a while. You know, it's about halfway through your watch, and you haven't really seen any other traffic. And you certainly haven't seen anyone doing business. It's, you know, like 2 in the morning at this point.
All right.
So it definitely strikes you as unusual that these people have stopped there. Or even that a palanquin would make its way out of the city at this point. And as you watch, the carriers of the palanquin go and knock on the door of the business, and the door is quickly opened. There's a short discussion, and you see one of them hand over a large purse of some kind, and the door shuts again, and the two carriers proceed to go kind of around the back of the building, and when they return, they have three saddled, what look like fairly well-bred horses. And they take them over to where the palanquin sits.
Could I attempt to continue this ruse and like make my way across the street, continuing this more or less of a drunken stupor, making my way across the street to better inspect this palanquin to see if it has any of the kind of marks that Xavier might have described for us.
Okay.
See if it matches the one that he saw.
You make your way, again, kind of assuming this ruse of inebriation, and the business, you know, again, you're observing this. It's a moonlit night. It's not like it's pitch black outside. But you're only able to see what's going on because of your low light vision. And as you make your way closer, you can see a little bit more clearly. And while you're trying to make your way closer, you see a robed figure in some form of dark robe. You know, it's hard to tell whether it's black or some other color.
Yeah.
Get out of the palanquin and mount the horse that has been brought over. And you can tell that the horse has reacted extremely nervously. Like it's skittish and kind of, you know, seems almost afraid of what's happening. And I need you to make me an animal handling check or an insight check.
I'll go animal handling.
Okay. You know, you've spent some time around horses. You know, it's not something that you've never worked in a stable or anything like that.
Right.
But the horse does seem to be disturbed by something. And this figure mounts the horse, and the two men who'd been carrying the palanquin mount the other two horses, and they begin to ride in your direction.
Is the palanquin being left there?
It is.
Alright, so I'll just do my best to kind of pick up anything specific about these guys as they try to make their way by. Or as they do make their way by. I'm not going to try to stop them or anything. And then, assuming nothing else happens, I'm just going to go and inspect that palanquin.
Okay.
And kind of keeping an eye on where they're going as far as I can see. Like to see if they're heading back towards the city or if they're heading to the northern direction.
All right. So, make me a perception check.
All right.
Okay, so as you make your way, still trying to hold up the ruse of drunkenness, towards where the palanquin's been left, the three riders, the two former, you know, litter bearers, now flanking the rider in the middle, begin to ride relatively quickly. They're not, you know, they're not sprinting their horses or anything, but they're definitely already picking up the pace, as if they're going to be riding, you know, for a decent distance they want to get there. And because there's a rider between you and the one you're most interested in, you can't really pick up any details.
All right.
But they, you know, as they pass you by, they seem to just ignore you, and they continue on, and you just see as you continue making your way towards the pallet, but they just continue to ride.
As they are making their way by, could I cast Hunter's Mark on the one I'm most interested in?
Certainly could.
All right. So I leave.
As he yells out, and your mark.
And your mark.
It's the black spot.
Concentration lasts for up to an hour. It's only a verbal component spell.
Mm-hmm.
So if you'd like, I could try to, like, I don't know, like, conceal that with stealth if you want. But otherwise, I basically mark this guy, and until the hour is up, anytime I try to perceive anything, anytime I make a roll about him, I have advantage on perception checks and survival checks to find him.
Okay.
And I would also know if he drops to zero hit points, which probably isn't going to be likely.
Okay.
So. And I can also do extra damage to him if we come to combat.
If.
But yeah.
All right. So you have successfully marked your target.
All right.
And now that you have this arcane connection to it, the riders continue on, and you can feel this, you know, the target, the, I don't know, somehow the sense of that figure continues to recede from you.
All right. And are they heading back? Did you say they're heading back towards the city, or
they're heading north?
Heading north. All right. So quickly, gonna run up to this palanquin, give it a once over, and just start sprinting back to where
okay,
people
so you,
are sleeping.
Are you gonna wait until they're out of sight, or are you just gonna?
Book it I'm as gonna soon make as my past way you? As soon as they're past me. Yeah, I'm gonna make my way towards where they bought the horses, where they left the palanquin.
Okay. All right. You make your way.
Yeah.
And about the time that you get there and start to look it over, you notice that there are two figures coming from around the back of that building where the horses came from, who are making their way also towards the palanquin. They seem to be humans that have the look of, you know, common laborers, even stable hands. But they don't seem to have noticed you yet, but they are making their way towards you.
All right. How far are they from me, and how close am I to the palanquin?
At this point, you are at the palanquin.
Okay.
And they are about 100 feet away from you.
All right. So I just want to, like, quickly throw open the curtains on my side,
check inside for anything that might have been left over, look about the outside of it for any distinguishing marks, then just make my way out.
Okay. Make me a... I guess an investigation check.
All right.
So you can see that this palanquin has seen some rough service. You couldn't say for sure whether it's the same one that Xavier saw, but it has kind of a similar feel to it, I guess. You know, it looks kind of run, from what you can tell, it looks kind of run down. The curtains are, you know, they're not real fancy. They're not like thick velvet or anything like that.
All right.
And as you take a quick glance around, you don't see any sort of, you know, anything that's been left behind that's obvious.
And I didn't have to follow these guys very far to get to this particular location. Like, effectively, if I were to want to come back during the daytime, I'd be able to do that, right?
Yeah, this place is, you know, okay. It's within sight of the encampment where you've been.
Okay.
Yeah, it's clearly just another merchant's business. Your confidence that you could ask Akin Celebon, you know, who it is or what they do, and he'd almost certainly be able to give you a detailed...
My thoughts exactly. All right, so yeah, after giving it a quick once over, I'm just going to turn around and head out.
Okay. And as you make your way away from it, you see that the two humans don't seem to have noticed you, but they come over and pick the thing up, you know, like they were porters, and carry it back around the back of the building.
All right, so yeah, just heading right back to the campsite where everybody's at. I'm going to start rousing people up.
No, Aragorn. I already had my watch. Someone else's turn.
Listen, I believe the cultist might already be on the move. Saw a selective group of them, three of them, with that device that they were carrying around inside the city that I believe Xavier spotted, or at the very least something like it. I wasn't able to get a good glance at them, but they might be on the move.
So are we supposed to follow them right now? I'm so tired.
If we want to act on this, we're going to have to move fast.
Well, I suppose we must get up then. Does this mean we're not going to be traveling with the caravan?
If we are tailing them for far, perhaps not.
Well, I suppose we best get up the others then.
And quickly rousing Numa, Caden, Chesco, Xavier.
They all grumble and complain. Particularly Chesco, as he's trying to recover from grievous battle wounds.
Is it my watch already?
Afraid not, Xavier. We may have cultists to be following.
How did they move so many through in so short a time?
Only a select few that I caught glimpse of. I believe I caught glimpse of. They were carrying around...
Get us into.
They were carrying around the device similar to the one you described to us earlier. They left it at one of the nearby stable masters, I believe it was, and took off to the north each mounted upon a horse.
We're not going to catch them if we don't have horses of our own.
Precisely, but we may at least be able to get some information from the stable master.
Or if we want to break into his business in the middle of the night.
Or if he's doing business at this hour, simply speak to him. Perhaps some coin might persuade him to loosen his tongue.
I think
at the very least we could purchase a horse and begin pursuit. See if anything comes of that.
Well, you do the talking. I will go around back and see if I can find something from the shadows.
They left behind their... I don't know why, but now I'm blanking on the actual
palanquin? Word.
The palanquin. They left behind the palanquin when they took off on the horses. I believe they were bringing it back around to the stables. I took off before they were able to grab hold of it. Stable masters, that is. But at the very least, you might be able to tell if this was the same one you spotted before.
All right, well, let's go get ourselves into some more trouble.
And Aravan's going to place his palm upon Chesco and heal him up 10 more hit points.
Oh.
Okay.
So I will activate the Cloak of Elvenkind for the stealthiness, and soon as Aravan is out and points us to the building, I am taking a back route to try to get to the back of the lot.
Okay.
Stealthy, of course.
You'd like to make me your stealth roll with advantage?
I'd love to.
Okay. So, I could also get, or I guess, are the rest of you guys attempting to stealth? Or is it just Xavier?
I'm just going to go to the front doors.
I'll just follow Aravan.
Xavier and Chesco can go background. They're a good duo.
Yeah, you know, so
God.
I have to add someone to the call.
Gosh!
Is it Chip?
We can find out what Numa's gonna do.
Numa's like, I'm gonna go kick some plates in the middle of the night.
If I can figure out how to add him to the call.
Damn it, Jesse.
Oh, there he is.
I'm sorry. I don't know what I'm doing.
What's going on, boss man?
Hey. Phew! Little
so
kinder
missed...
holiday cheer from kindergartners this evening.
Oh goodness!
You missed the recap, so you have to give it.
See, last week I was in Raleigh. Numa, I think, sat wondering where our compadres went to for such a long time to bring us back. No intel. Is that
good
what
summer.
I remember?
No, that's
summer.
That's,
yeah.
That's good.
Sounds about right.
All right.
I'm sure there
well,
was some death involved in there somewhere.
Chip, I will
there
nominate,
was a death.
I will nominate Ryan or one of the others to fill you in on what's happened so far tonight.
Are we guarding a caravan yet?
Not yet. No.
And
but...
the rest of us will take a break. So.
Okay.
Be right back.
So, currently what's going on is everybody is going to be employed for a caravan when the total caravan itself takes off in about 3 to 4 days. And about the time that happens, we're hoping that the remaining of the dragon cultists are making their way north as well. But as we are resting up this night, right after Xavier and Chesco got back from fighting with number of those assassin dudes that came after him in the alley. We were just in the middle of taking our separate watches, kind of keep an eye out on things, and Aravan spotted a palanquin leaving the city's gates
and followed it to a nearby kind of stable master place where they ditched the palanquin, got on, and three of them got on horses and took off to the north. And right now, Aravan just kind of made his way back and he's waking everybody up to be like, hey guys, so things may or may not be happening right now. And if we want to follow these guys, we need to do it now before they get too far ahead of us.
Gotcha. Yeah. Cool. Well, I just cannot wait to guard a caravan. I think that this will be a wonderful career move for Numa.
He's going to give up on the adventuring life and just stick with the caravan.
Yeah.
Tell my master I'm sorry, but
a monk,
I think I found myself.
And his caravan.
Maybe he'll run his own caravan someday.
Yeah, there you go. So
yeah, right now, Xavier is sneaking around to the back to see what they did with the palanquin. And Aravan and I think Octavia are making their way to the front doors of the business to talk with the guy directly to see if maybe like some coin might loosen him up a bit to talk about what just happened.
Cool. How do I do this? So what was our the host address? Dark Seal Monk something?
I think so, yeah.
Dark Seal Monk. There's another word there somewhere. Dark Seal Monk. Dark Seal Monk. I'm trying to go back to the texts from last week when I asked the same question.
Let's see if I have any.
It's another four-letter word. Dark Seal Monk something.
Dark Seal Huge Monk.
Ah, Dark Seal Huge Monk. Okay.
Of course.
Yes. How could I forget? Logical progression of four-letter words.
Now we know that Xavier's the dark and Numa's the monk, but who's the seal and who is huge?
Thank you.
Hey, Birdie.
Yeah, buddy.
We're ready.
Ready and willing.
Ready with more drinks.
Do you need more?
So
we'll find out after this conversation with the stable master.
What was the decision about stealthing, not stealthing, how we're making our way to the stables? The business.
I am not stealthy.
So, Aravan and Octavia are going to the front door. I guess Caden can come with them if Numa wants to sneak around back. Or if Numa comes with us, Caden can sneak around back.
Definitely not letting those two guys go off by themselves again. Definitely not.
Sure. It's probably smarter that way.
Yeah, Numa may not know a lot, but he knows that now.
No. Yeah, let's not get all the horses murdered. Innocent horses. At least 12 of them.
You guys don't even know.
Shatter in the stable.
We only know what you told us, but that's still not good.
All right, so anyone who's sneaking, I need you to make a stealth roll.
Is this a tower roll or a?
Yes.
Now, what are you eating?
More sausage balls.
Allie, quit spoiling him.
She can't hear you.
She knows in her soul. I'm there.
Of course, I heard the other half of that sentence. Quit spoiling him and start spoiling me.
Well, at least you understand, too.
Okay, so you guys see the building that Air Vince pointed out and kind of take a roundabout trajectory. And back behind the building, you can see a large corral and a small-ish stable. It's like it's been up for 5 or 6 horses. But there are several horses, probably 10 or 15 at the least, just kind of loose in the corral area.
Is the palanquin back there?
It's not immediately obvious.
Alright, so I'm going to try to look for that quietly. And see if it's the one that I saw earlier.
Okay. Make me a perception or investigation roll.
Absolutely. No hidden traps, right?
Nope. As you make your way around, you kind of look around the stable in the back of the other building. It's clearly not just out in the open anywhere. And even though the stable seems to be more or less closed up, as you come up to it, you can see there are gaps in some of the boards. And the doors have been mostly pushed together, but there's also a gap there. And as you look in, you can see that the palanquin has been put inside one of the horse's stalls inside the stable.
Do I see any movement in there besides horses?
No, in fact, you don't even see any horses.
Oh.
Seems that the stable is empty, as far as you can tell.
I would like to carefully check the door for traps and then enter.
Okay. Your previous investigation roll will serve for that. Okay. And it looks like it's just essentially a barn door. It's not, from what you can tell, it's not even locked because it's not, the door has not been closed all the way. It looks like the gap is left basically enough to facilitate a breeze inside the barn, the stable.
And I'll go through and just thoroughly investigate the palanquin.
And as you thoroughly investigate the palanquin, maybe another investigation check.
Certainly.
So as you begin kind of looking it over thoroughly, you can't be for sure whether this is the same palanquin or not. I mean, it looks to be in similar condition, but you just can't tell whether it's actually the exact same one or not.
Can I look for claw marks where that guy put his hand? And sure. see if there was anything specifically, like where he came out, where I saw. Do you want another investigate for that?
Nope, just want to finish chewing the sausage ball. Okay. I was giving you the thumbs up in the...
I was looking at my feet, I'm sorry.
Thumbs up, like, absolutely, there's claw marks, and there's also the guy.
Thumbs up, like, I understand, I'm getting to it.
It's actually a note that said I was here.
I was here, the black dragon guy that tried to have you killed.
So, GPS tracker left behind.
Ben, could you see my rolls?
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm completely connected. I don't see anybody else's stuff.
Well, everybody's been rolling in the tower so far, so.
Okay. Well, I figured it'd still say a stealth check or something. Like it usually
I think it's I set know. To only.
Hey, I saw that. Can see your Thank rolls. You. Thank okay, you. I'll take it. Yes.
Right, so, as you look where you're sure that that you saw that claw reach out and grab the pillar. I think there may be some scratches there, but you can't tell whether they're like scratches from a claw or just general chips and dings on the palanquin or what.
Chip, what are you doing back here?
I'm dinging.
So, with that, you know, fruitless endeavor, I'm going to go back and see if there's a back door into the building.
There doesn't really seem to be a back door. You do see there's a loft and a ladder that leads up to it. And I think you hear some light rustling up there.
I'm going to slowly make my way up that ladder. Quietly.
And then okay, maybe another stealth check.
Peek my head in there.
Is the floor just a dirt floor or stone or?
Well, are you back there? Yes, you are. You roll a stealth check. Floor is just a dirt floor.
This doesn't involve my cloak, right? So I wouldn't get advantage on this one.
I'm gonna say you'll still get advantage. Okay. So, as you start making your way up the ladder, you can kind of tell this thing is probably prone to squeaking. So you're very careful and very slowly put your weight on it. And you manage to minimize any noises as it shifts and settles as you're trying to climb it. You get just to where you can see into the loft. And as you'd expect, it has hay up there. There's a couple of large piles of hay shoved over into one corner. There's also some hay kind of spread out just along the boards at the loft, and you can see what look like two bedrolls kind of laid out on top of the straw. And on those two bedrolls, you see two humanoid figures. That seemed to be laying there. What appears to be asleep.
Do their attire look anything like the ones carrying the palanquins before or the assassins?
It's hard to tell because you're kind of seeing their feet.
Oh, okay.
But it, as you can tell, they just, if they're wearing kind of typical workers' clothing.
Okay, I'll look back to, I assume, Chesco and Numa, and I'll do a hand sign saying that I see two people in the loft laying down. And then I'll shrug my shoulders.
Numa, make me for an insight check.
Oh, God.
Did you decide to roll your own dice?
No, I was rolling mine over here.
Chip.
What?
Can you make me an insight check?
You. I mean, I didn't. If you said something, I didn't hear you. It broke up. All I heard was the robot murmurs.
Awesome.
So did I understand his two people naked upstairs on the bed signal? Was that what we were doing?
That's almost exactly what you got out of it. That he's seeing two people, and they're, like, doing things up in the loft that you just don't think you should go up there.
Yeah, post-coital situation there.
Bunch of teenagers snuck into this loft.
Let's play Milkmaid and the Stable Boy.
All these thoughts are running through your head.
Yeah, those are exactly the thoughts that we go through on Monk's head.
Yeah, what kind of monastery were you at?
What kind of role playing am I doing here?
No, you're thinking
totally.
The signals you got from him, you're thinking, oh, those damn kids, always thinking about nothing but sex.
Yeah, that's right. Where's my reed? Okay. So geographically or spatially, this stable is connected to a house, or, I mean, am I missing something there? We're trying to find where the people who had the carrying device run off to. Is that what we're?
Well, we know that they ran off to the north.
They ran off to the north.
I think we're trying to talk to this guy and see if we can get information as to,
okay,
if he knew.
I got you.
Why they went that way. Or who they were. Or anything.
Yep, I got you.
Yeah. So what you know is that Aravan saw a palanquin come out of the city. They stopped in front of this place of business. The two carriers went up.
Right, yeah.
Exchanged money. Horses were delivered. The three people, the two carriers, and the one person in the palanquin.
We're trying to figure out. Yeah.
Yep. That's what you know.
Okay.
And off they went.
What does Numa say?
What? I didn't. Did I say something? I'm good.
So back to the front door.
Yes.
Yeah. I thought there was a front door somewhere. So that was the front door to.
Octavia, what are you guys doing?
We're going.
I think Aravan is knocking on the door, and I'm standing like diagonally.
Making my way.
up to the front door, I would like to use the hat of disguise to make myself appear as Cyanrath, the Dragonborn, as I pull out his greatsword and knock very heavily on the front door.
I will still stand diagonally behind him.
So you want to make yourself look like a half-dragon?
Yes.
I'll be right back in 1 second. I'm still here.
If I hear this knocking, I would like to not be in the way of those guys coming out.
Now, there's like an office building, and then like a separating space, kind of like a courtyard, and then a stable behind it. Ah. You're in the stable.
Oh, I meant that I wanted to sneak into the back of the business.
Yeah, so we snuck back.
Okay.
I guess that's where I'm confused. That's where I'm.
Yeah,
because that's where the palace was. The
stables, yeah.
Well, no, I get that. I guess, it's like, well, I'm done here. That's fine.
So I guess that's why I'm spatially confused, because I don't know what the.
Okay, well, front the two door... people you saw in the loft were in the stable.
Mm-hmm. Right, but the front door to the stable is. I mean, no, is the stable door. Behind? Stable is behind this building.
Yes.
Or the other party members at the front door, right?
Yeah.
Correct.
So okay. We're at the office building. You guys are at the stable building.
Gotcha.
Okay.
But we've not entered the house that the stable
was. Think of it this way.
To.
Correct.
You are currently standing in 102.
Under. Okay. Thank you.
And the rest of the group is. You ready to knock on the front door of 107?
Yes. Okay.
That kind of spatial arrangement.
Okay.
Which means I'm sneaking up the wrong building, and I would like to not sneak up the wrong building.
Yeah, I guess we're in a totally different part.
My MO.
You guys are just being peeping Toms.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
What are the neighbors up to at this hour?
I was about ready to kill somebody. I'm moving.
So, now that you've seen what's happening in the stables,
I can't leave you alone.
We're going to the front door of the other building.
Yeah.
So, everyone, you said you're changing into Cyanrath, and
making sure his greatsword is out and very visible, and giving a heavy knock on the front door.
There's no answer.
I'm just going to continue to pound very heavily on the front door.
After a few minutes, you see what looks like a lantern being lit inside. And someone comes up and... what it sounds like they're working with some sort of bar or something behind the door.
As I can start to hear the door being unlocked, I'd like to grab a pouch of 150 gold pieces and just get that ready.
Okay.
All right.
Do you have a pouch of 150 gold pieces?
Yes.
Okay. So, the door opens, and a very angry-looking human man opens it, and he's already starting to say, "What the hell do you think you're?"
And I would just like to shove this pouch of coins into his chest very heavily as I do so.
Okay. He is still standing there, like, mouth agape, has no idea what to do.
And then Aravan's going to say, "Three horses. You promised them at this hour. Where are they? You've made me wait long enough."
I'm just going to cross my arms.
And he starts to stutter and...
But they were already... picked up the
They were already paid for it and taken.
Paid for and taken by who? I'm standing right here. And my patience grows ever thinner.
I don't know. They brought the money and so they showed up at the right time. I didn't know who it was for. I just, you know, do you, horses. Okay, I can get you horses. I can do that.
For my horses. We made a deal. And I expect you to be followed through upon.
The arrangement was made. I don't know who it was for. They just brought the coin. It was just a business deal. I don't know what's going on. They just wanted horses, and they wanted them available. I just.
How many half dragons could you possibly be dealing with at this hour in the night?
I don't know anything about half dragons. I swear, I don't know anything about half dragons.
Clearly, is there someone of a higher rank that I could speak to? Your manager, someone in charge, someone who has an inkling as to what is going on in this establishment?
This is my establishment. I can get you horses. If you need horses, I can get you horses. I have plenty. I can have them saddled right now. I can just tell me what 3 horses. I can get that. I can get 3 horses.
You better stop talking and start moving.
And with that, he kind of nods vigorously and turns around and, like, darts towards the back of the building.
Could I make
Aravan and kind of shrug, like, I don't know.
Could I make a kind of, like, insight check to see if he was doing, like, a double take to see, like, a second Dragonborn, or if he was, like, genuinely just put off?
Go ahead and make an insight check.
All right.
This is going to be terrible. He walks out back and there's 3 people rummaging around his farm.
As far as you can tell, he seems genuinely shocked.
All right.
So, he is making his way through the kind of the office slash house. And he goes barreling out a back door. And he starts, he's not running, but he's quickly making his way across the open area between the house and the stable. And as soon as he gets to the stable door and starts to push it open, he starts yelling, "Enos! Kennet! Get up! Get up now!" At this point, it's been long enough that I will assume that Xavier has left the ladder and that you guys had made your way back out of the stable.
I like that assumption.
Mm-hmm. Standing right over the 2 boys as they wake up.
I have a thought.
Unless you'd prefer to be there.
I better not.
Okay.
I'll be hiding somewhere in the lot, but not in the stable.
You can basically just be like right around the corner of the stable.
Yeah.
And you hear through the walls of the stable rustling and mutterings, and this guy yelling up there, hurry up now, get down here, get me 3 good horses, saddle them quickly. And he kind of stands there, and you can, again, because there's some gaps in the siding, you can kind of see inside a little bit, and you can see him rummaging around, grabbing, you know, saddles and putting them down, prepared for horses to come in and be saddled. And the two, you know, teenage boys end up, you know, coming down the ladder, running out the main door of the stable and into the lot behind the stable. They paid no attention to you guys whatsoever. And they run out and start trying to gather up a few horses. You can see the horses in the stable still have like a lead. They're not saddled. They don't have, you know, the bridle in or any of that kind of stuff. But they quickly round up three more horses and lead them through the gate and into the stable. And inside the stable, you can see that they're furiously getting these three horses saddled and ready to go. So, Erevan, what are you and Octavia doing in the meantime? This operation is taking them probably 5 to 8 minutes.
Does he leave the door open?
He most certainly did.
I'm going to walk inside and see if there's like a desk with some paperwork on it.
I think Caden came with us.
Yeah.
Yes, he did.
Okay. I'll kind of point Caden and after Octavia to tell him to find what he can, and I'll make my way outside to find this guy once again. To just look very impatient.
Okay.
And kind of do my best to also kind of stall him to give them a little bit more time.
So let's see. Someone needs to take ownership of Caden.
Good, Ryan.
Who's all right.
Neighbor's dog's barking now.
Oh, okay, good. It's like, damn it, dogs.
I can certainly try.
He's not even on my fantasy grounds. Well, that'd be NPCs, huh? No, that'd be...
No, PCs.
PCs, obviously.
Okay. So, Octavia and Caden, I can get them to make investigation checks.
On the open or to you?
In the tower.
Hello. I'm so curious.
Dropped it right next to the tower again. I'm very happy I sent him in here. He's got a +6 on his investigation.
Oh.
Okay.
That's fine.
And both of you also make me a perception check.
Alright.
There's going to be someone else in the room watching us.
Half dragon, maybe?
Are you friends of my grandsons?
Stay a while and listen.
So, as Erevan makes his way out the back door to go harass the poor merchant. Octavia and Caden begin kind of rummaging through whatever loose paperwork they can find. You do see that there is an empty, what looks like coin purse, tossed onto the desk.
That are there any, like, symbols the center of the or room. Anything on it?
No, it just seems like a plain leather bag that is about the size of a coin purse.
Okay.
It does seem to be empty, however. And, you know, underneath the leather bag, you find basically what amounts to a receipt that says three horses, good saddles, you know, feed for a 10-day, and, you know, just kind of tallies up all the different things that were being provided to be picked up on the night of whatever today is.
That's today.
So, yeah. Today, I haven't been keeping up with the
calendar.
In-game calendar?
Yeah, the in-game calendar particularly well, so it's now December going to be
13th.
Kai Thorn 24.
Nope. It's going to be Flame Rule the Fourth.
Happy Flame Rule the Fourth.
Yay, fireworks.
So. No, it's not. It's this. Right. When do I get the date to update?
Date.
Can't remember. Maybe. Nope. That way. That way. Arr.
Well, does the receipt have any kind of
anyway.
Name on it? Like, to be delivered to X or picked up by so-and-so? Partially paid?
No, it doesn't have a anything like partially paid or on behalf of. It does have a statement at the top that, see, I've done it to myself again. I can't remember the name of the merchant that I had mentioned before.
That you weren't
the one from last week.
Oh, the dick merchant?
He sells dicks by the bag?
Yeah, Timor.
Timor.
I got him written down as the dick merchant. So.
Yeah, that's that's reasonable.
I wonder how much business he actually gets.
Yeah. So,
is that spotted dick?
Yes. Pickled
dicks
spotted
by the bag.
It just says at the top, Timor Zeus. Zhooss.
Like, that's the name of this guy's business?
No, like handwritten. That's, like, that's the name, on the receipt.
Okay.
And the tally of all the costs is 100 gold pieces.
Wow, we overpaid.
Well, maybe the new guy.
Ponies.
I like that. You overpaid. So far you've walked in, threatened, basically intimidated the merchant, and haven't given him anything, but we overpaid.
Well, he says I had 150. I'm going to demand 50 back for him wasting our time.
You're not in the same room.
Sorry. I need to revise that. A riding horse should cost 75 gold pieces. So it says 300 gold pieces.
300.
Good deal.
All right.
And as they're, you know, rummaging through all this stuff, Octavia, you catch out of the corner of your eye a glimpse of movement, and you hear the sound of feet moving upstairs.
Is the stairway nearby?
Yeah, the stairs are kind of over on the left-hand side of the main room where you are. And, of course, it's fairly dark in there. No one's... Or, actually, no, I guess he left the lamp. So there's a lamp lit downstairs, or a lantern that is lit downstairs. Humans. So you guys can see. And you just get the distinct impression there's someone upstairs. Of course, the merchant came down in what looked like, you know, bedclothes.
I'm just going to keep looking for, like, information, like, if he has any other paperwork or anything. I'm going to be quieter. Like, do I know if that person saw me?
You don't know. You just saw movement and heard the feet.
Yeah, I'm not gonna intrude in their house, like, completely. I'm just gonna look for information. Like, I'm gonna take this receipt paper, and, like, I'm gonna look around and see if there's any other, like, the symbol that we saw on the doors. I'm gonna look for that, and anything else that might connect him to the cult, dragon stuff or anything.
Yeah, Caden's just going to assist with that.
Okay.
Kind of seeing as of how we know there's a lot more guys coming, checking to see if there's any future tense paperwork.
I am going to look. Like. I'm going to look to Caden and kind of like give him like the whisper and then point upstairs. Like, we have to be quiet because there's someone upstairs.
So. Caden nods at you. As you continue to look through, you know, you find papers and things that, you know, you can't really scrutinize them, but they seem to just be on normal business dealings, principally in horses, and, you know, feed and, you know, leather for saddles and different things like that, you know, shodding and iron for horseshoes, and you know, there's a lot of just various and sundry business documents, but nothing that leaps out at anyone as, you know, oh well, I have a caravan of 25 cultists who are coming through, so I need to be prepared. Yeah.
Can I get 400 horses for Tuesday?
Right.
Okay, so yeah, I'll just leave. I'll go back outside and if I don't see anything else.
Does Caden still have his cat familiar?
He sure does.
Ooh, kitty cat going upstairs.
He's able to see through its eyes, right?
Yep.
Is that a thing?
Mm-hmm. Mrs. Cooper.
Could Caden follow Octavia and send his familiar to check upstairs?
He's blind and deaf while looking through the senses, but he can do anything else.
It takes basically your senses go
in place
to
of him, yeah.
So yeah, if he wants to go outside first and then kind of sit and then send the cat, fine. That's perfectly okay.
All right, so that's what he's gonna do. Kind of.
Okay.
Wait till.
And where
out.
Are you sending the cat?
Up the stairs.
All right, so the cat is moving as if on cat's feet. And is extremely quiet. And as it gets up to the top of the stairs, you know, you can kind of look over and see that there is a what looks like a fairly frightened woman clutching a small crossbow, like sitting on the edge of a bed. And kind of staring just out at the stairs, you know, hoping that nothing comes up, and listening. You know, she seems to have a window up open behind her, trying to listen to for any, you know, unusual noises or.
All right. So as a cat, can I just glance about the room and give a meow and then run back down the stairs?
Sure.
All right.
Oh, God. Don't kill his familiar.
Nah. It'll be all right.
Intention to kill the cat.
You monster.
But at least I know you're related.
If it happens, better the cat than Caden.
I suppose.
He can get another one.
And, you know, this very scared woman seems to have been, you know, listening and kind of not so much looking waiting to hear footsteps come up the stairs or something like that. And at the point where the cat meows, she jumps and the crossbow fires and it sails and goes right into the wall next to the door in the room where she was sitting.
So yeah, cat's absolutely going to take off at that.
It really works better for the cat to leave, you know, now she knows that she's getting the cat away. And that may have been all she heard downstairs.
Yeah, it was probably this cat pounding on the door.
Well, not that part, but, you know, rummaging through papers and shit.
All right. So, yeah, with that, I guess Caden would come back to his senses. Now, like, it's just a white. Nothing upstairs.
And I'll assure him to leave. We should probably get up. I won't say anything, but I'll like wave him on, and I'll walk out.
I'll kind of like whisper that to her, knowing that this woman was trying to listen through the window. So I'll try to say it outside of her earshot.
And all this time, you know, Erevan as Cyanrath has been intimidating and hurrying along the merchant and his stable hands, and they are clearly nervous. They keep kind of like dropping things and having to hurriedly pick them up, and they're trying to quickly saddle the horses. And unlike what you saw before, the horses don't really seem to be reacting to you.
These horses have true sight. They know. All right.
Success.
And eventually they get the horses saddled, and the merchant turns back to you and says,
there you go, my three of my best horses, saddles and feed and everything that you requested. I hope that's I'm so sorry. I had no idea that someone else would come and pay for your order and take your horses.
I'm extremely frustrated that it's taken this long to get something I'd reserved ahead of time.
I am so sorry. I don't know how there could have been a mix-up like this. But as you can see, they're ready to go. So if you want to just leave the payment for 300 gold, as we had agreed, you just go right on your way.
We agreed on 300 gold to pick them up at the appropriate time. Due to this delay, I can at the very least only expect some sort of recompense for the time I've spent wasted here.
You are so right. How about 210 and 90 gold? Surely 10 gold for a short delay is more than sufficient.
How about 250?
And you can see him like visibly wince. And he then looks at your greatsword. And
I would like to tightly grip this greatsword as I continue telling him, like, because I wasted the time beforehand coming through to his worthless business associates in order to put through this reservation, which clearly had no purpose whatsoever, as the items I had ordered were not nearly ready in the time that I had specified, and just gripping the sword tighter and tighter as I do so, trying to intimidate this guy.
Okay, make an intimidation check.
All right.
He is pretty scared. And it's really more the half dragon thing that's throwing him. And so he says,
of course, 250 gold. All right, that will be perfectly acceptable.
All right, so I fill coin purse of 250 beautiful gold pieces.
Can I see this going on?
Yes, actually, you can.
And I see Erevan.
You see Cyanrath.
I recognize the sword, though.
And you see Cyanrath.
Okay. Well,
am I back there, okay, or did we just leave the house?
I assume this is happening while you guys are inside.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, while you guys are searching, he has gone to the stable.
Okay.
I'm going to... about how far from them am I?
Probably 15 feet. You're on the other side of the barn, or effectively the barn wall.
Okay.
Watching through a crack.
Alright, so I'm going to go ahead and cast my mage hand. Keep it invisible.
Rob me of the rest of my gold.
No, I'm going to rob him. Because I'm thinking that he's working with the cult.
Alright.
So once the coin trades hands, I'm going to attempt to take it from him.
Okay.
With the mage.
As the gold changes hands, he is gripping very tightly to this bag because he is scared for his life, and is just kind of shaking. I mean, you can see him. You know, if this were the bag, he'd be doing this number, kind of like, "Is there anything else you need?"
I think I've had quite enough of your business.
And he looks at his two stable hands and says, "Now, boys, let's." Take the horses outside for our customer, and they reluctantly each take one of the bridles of the horses, and he leaves, you know, he hands you the bridle of the other.
Right, and I just walk them back out front and kind of start shouting, "The horses are ready, we have little more time to waste," like, effectively hoping to give them a bit of a heads up that we're coming back round to the front. Not sure if they're finished yet or not.
Okay. And as you walk the horses back around to the front of the building, there stands Caden and Octavia, and you see a cat walk out the front door.
I believe we've wasted enough time here. Shall we? And I'll walk towards the horses.
And Caden kind of, you know, stands up a little straighter and starts looking at you. And as he's walking away, you see the cat, like, step behind him, and then it's just gone.
All right, so Erevan, as Cyanrath is going to kind of shout out, hopping up onto his own horse that he's been given, "We've wasted enough time. It's time to leave Baldur's Gate and just take off to around the corner."
To around the corner.
As close as he can get that's out of sight, out of line of sight from this place.
And line of hearing, so he won't hear the galloping stuff.
Okay, so effectively you guys ride these horses kind of to the end of the road.
Could I then take in Octavia and Caden, just start trying to track these horses with my hunter's mark?
Is hunter's mark a concentration spell?
Yes, it is.
And the hat doesn't require concentration. Hunter's mark lasts for how long?
An hour.
Okay. I would say, given all this, you've probably got about 20 minutes left on your hunter's mark.
All right, so I would like to get the most out of that as I can. Just start taking off. And once we get out of earshot, telling Octavia and Caden what's going on so they can turn back if they want to let the other guys know what's happening, but letting them know I've got a limited time to find out, as far as I can track these guys, where they're going.
Okay. And you, relying on the sense of connection that you have with your hunter's mark, you take off, and I don't, you know, Octavia and Caden can decide to follow as they will. But you basically just follow the main road, and you leave the outskirts of the encampment to the north of Baldur's Gate, and continue to follow the main, you know, trade road, if you will. And you continue to do so for the next 20 minutes, and finally the connection you feel fades, but it seems to be continuing just on to the north.
All right. So with that, I'm going to kind of slow the horse and let him know that I've lost him, or at the very that the spell is up. But it seems that they are continuing north along the tradeway. But they have indeed left, seems to have left Baldur's Gate.
So, do you believe we should follow them tonight, or with the caravan, if we know they're no longer with the caravan?
Knowing they're already out of the city is one thing, but we do know that more of their numbers have to be making their way through the city, we presume, at some point. At the very least, we know they don't have a hideout incredibly close nearby, or nor are they taking shelter in one of the houses on the outskirts of Baldur's Gate. It seems that they are indeed making their way full speed along the coastway.
Well, if we go back, what should we do with these horses?
At the very least, we'll be doing a little bit less walking with the caravans. But to the best of my own ability, I don't believe the man who sold these horses was in league with the cultists nor knew anything more about them.
As you guys are having that conversation, we're going to go back to 20 minutes prior as the rest of the group is sitting there hiding behind a stable as you see Octavia, Caden, and a half blue dragon Cyanwrath mount up and take off.
What just happened?
I don't know.
Isn't that the guy we killed? Did we kill that guy?
You have every reason to believe you did.
I have no idea who you're talking about.
The blue... Oh, that's right, Rogue. You weren't there yet. Could have sworn we killed a half-dragon blue guy in his cave.
But Chesco and Numa both are convinced they killed that half-dragon.
Looked just like that guy. And Octavia's with him now.
Uh-oh.
I'm totally confused.
Well, he's
with us. So who's it's me, Caden, and Xavier? Yep. Is that who's hiding behind you?
It's you, Xavier, and Chesco.
Chesco.
Oh, and Chesco. Okay.
And I'm trying to steal some money.
With your magic hand.
With my magic hand.
Okay. Right. So you can make, at this point, you can make an attempt at disadvantage.
Okay.
To attempt to steal this, or to mage hand this coin purse away from this guy.
Okay. And it says I can do that as a bonus action. You can perform the following. Okay. Cool. And a sleight of hand?
Sleight of hand with disadvantage.
Gotcha.
Okay. So, as this guy, you know, you can tell he is thoroughly shaken. He has, you know, followed Cyanwrath and his two stable hands outside, and has kind of, you know, basically tried to keep his distance as best he could, while not just abandoning his employees to whatever happens.
and in his distraction of trying to deal with all that, you manage to slip your mage hand up behind him and kind of cup the coin purse and just slowly grip it so that as he starts to kind of loosen his grip, it just oh so gently settles in your hand. You start to kind of tug, and as he's, you know, basically saying his last, you know, goodbye or whatever to Cyanrath, you kind of sneak it out of his hand and start bringing it right back towards you.
Yeah, I'm going to not bring it directly towards me. I'm going to bring it, if I'm seeing this right, I'm going to bring it to the, like, in between the stable and the building. If there's, like, a fence or something holding in the horses, I'm going to drop it on the other side of the fence, kind of, like, near a bush or something, if there's
okay.
over there. So I know I can go back and get it, but not directly bring it to me.
Okay. You can certainly manage that.
And then I would like to use the use my action to use the message spell. And I'm going to whisper Mr. Timmer and say, I'm trying to change my voice a little bit, saying...
Wait, who are you whispering?
Timmer. Zoss.
Oh, okay. Well, okay, first...
That one first.
You are trying to whisper the merchant who's in front of you, or specifically Timur Zoss?
I guess I don't know that it's Timur Zoss, so the merchant in front of me.
Okay.
Because I don't think I've seen his face yet.
You have seen Timur Zoss.
Right, you but talked I mean to him. In the stable.
Do well, I know that it's him? Just from general demeanor, tone of voice, all that kind of stuff, you don't, that this isn't him.
It isn't?
No.
Oh.
And in fact, as you start to think about it, you remember that Timur Zoss dealt more in bulk goods, foodstuffs, things like that.
Okay. Then I'll target the merchant. And I point my finger at him and I say, "You shouldn't deal with cultists."
And he kind of jerks around, starts looking for who might have said something. And at that point realizes that his coin purse is gone. And desperately starts looking around trying to figure out what happened to it.
That's all I do. I just gave him the warning and I took the gold. Staying hidden.
Okay. How long do you plan to stay hidden?
I'm gonna give it like at least 5 minutes. And then I'm going to try to jump the fence and swing around to get the gold.
Okay, well, over the next 5 minutes, as you guys are standing kind of behind the stables, you watch as this guy, like, searches around, you know, the ground around him, and then, like, makes a beeline back for the stable and looks around in there, trying to figure out if he... You know, he set it down somewhere, and eventually he goes, he kind of gives up the search and goes inside, and you hear, like, you know, bar, or not bars, but kind of the same effect as locks being locked every door he can find. And, you know, you see the window upstairs being shut after you hear his, or you hear voices coming from upstairs. And you can see, like, the windows being shut and, like, curtains being closed and all that kind of stuff.
and the stable hands?
He called them into the house.
Okay. Numa, Chesco, I think the coast is clear.
Where did they go?
Who?
Erevan.
I have no idea where Erevan is.
I suppose we should go back to the tent.
My question is, why is Octavia and Caden working with that blue dragon fellow?
Who knows?
I go by and grab the gold.
Okay.
I'll pocket it.
You have successfully stolen 250 gold from a merchant who was just robbed.
He hasn't had a bad day.
Okay. So, you have your gold, you have your crew. Are you heading back to the tents?
Well, Numa has no other earthly idea what to do than to go back to where he just came from.
That makes sense to me. We should go back to the tent and wait for, I guess, Erevan to show up. And tell him that Octavia and Caden ran off with this evil guy that you killed.
Yes.
So I'll stealthily go back to the tent.
Okay. Now going back to the group of riders, you've lost track of your quarry. You're a good hard 10-minute ride outside of town at this point. And you've just turned to your companions, whoever followed you, and told them that, you know, you've lost them, but they seem to be going north along the tradeway. What are you going to do?
Well, if we go back with these horses, I worry the vendor across the street will recognize them. But if we don't go back at all, I worry about what will happen to everyone.
Well, they provided us food and the like for them. I could make up a small camp just outside of town with the three horses. Are there any sorts of like distinguishing marks on the saddlebags or like brands on the horses or anything like that?
If you want to search them over, no, it does not appear that there's any really distinguishing marks. And from what you can remember of your knowledge of Baldur's Gate, the trade, you know, is particularly in goods like horses and wagons and things like that, tends to be brisk because any merchant who doesn't immediately turn around, you know, bring goods in, offload them, immediately turn around and goes back, ends up selling his wares to continue on to the other side of the city, we'll have to buy new ones.
Alright.
So they just seem to be kind of a, you know, the horses do seem a slight cut above your average horse.
But still kind of like a dime a dozen. Like, nothing really stands out about them.
Yeah, nothing. Now, you know, you haven't been around horses long enough to really know whether someone might recognize a horse just by the look. Right, especially like amongst several.
A guy who actually breeded the horses, a stable master might. But Erevan, as far as Erevan's concerned, nothing distinctly sticks out to him.
Exactly.
All right. I'll put it to Octavia and Caden. Like, if you don't want to bring the horses back, we paid for them.
I don't think we should bring that back at all.
Things just got out of hand. I need to get that on the soundboard button.
Seriously.
But I'm very confident that that merchant knew little about the cultist's dealings beyond what he told us.
I believe you're right, and I'm going to rummage through and grab that receipt I had and show it to him and Caden, and this is all I found, which is just the work order, really, but I can see who signed it, so that shows that he's involved, for sure. However, Caden and I, although you had a very, very believable disguise on, Caden and I believe we'd probably be recognizable for how fearful he was. I'm going to take off my armor and just put on my common clothes. And if my common clothes have a hood, I'm going to put my hood up. If we're going back, and I'm going to kind of stay like very like head down and not be noticeable if I can.
Okay.
If we decide to go back, that's what I'm doing.
From the two of them, between Octavia and Caden, who would probably stand out more in a crowd, would you say? Like, there's not one of them that's like 7 feet tall or like visible burns on the faces like or anything
humans,
like that.
Right? Yeah, you know, both are humans. Both, you know, Octavia probably would have with the armor just because, you know. It's not unusual to see people, especially guards, you know, walking around in some sort of armor. But I believe she's wearing like chainmail, which is a little more unusual.
I think that's what I have.
You should be if you're a starting clerk.
Yeah.
You know, Caden.
Scale mail, that's what I have.
Okay, so.
And Caden conspicuously looks to blend in. You know, he actually goes for a set of set of clothing that are just common, you know, nothing that would stand out.
Okay.
Yeah, I do have a set of common clothes, though, so if we decide to go back, I'm going to put those on and hide my hair. You know, I mean, it's just blonde hair.
And
you guys joined
the wrong organization. Order the gauntlet. You guys are being all stealthy.
I wasn't
so
stealthy.
So Aravan's
going to
take off the disguise.
Yeah, he was. He's a transformer.
Aravan's going to take off the hat of disguise and hand it over to Caden and kind of give him the ins and outs of it so Caden can disguise himself as Aravan reverts back to his elven nature. Tattoos visible. This way, at the very least, he's hoping they're a little less noticeable altogether.
Right, because they're traveling with a fairly an elf of more unusual appearance.
Yeah. Okay. Elf looks nothing like the Dragonborn he was. Caden can look nothing like he was before, and Octavia no longer in the armored garb and the like. So right. I think Caden's going to have to take like an hour to attune to the hat, and so after that, we can head back to town.
Okay.
Does he have a spell that he could just do that with?
He's got minor illusion, but I don't think that's strong enough.
I don't think he has alter self.
Yeah, at the very least, I wouldn't trust minor illusion with it, and I don't think he has any higher illusion spells.
He doesn't have disguise self.
Yeah.
I do. No spell slots, though.
So that's what Aaron's going to do.
So, do we meet up at the tent?
Yeah, heading back towards that.
Tent. Everybody comes back to the tent. It sounds like
I'm resting, by the way, when we get back in there.
Does Aravan still look like a blue dragon?
He does not.
Yeah. Nope.
Aravan looks like Aravan.
But Aravan looks like Aravan. Octavia is no longer wearing her armor, and they walk in with some random third person.
I jump up with a dagger and say, "Who's he?
What is going on?"
This is Caden, and it would seem that the stable master was perhaps not in league with the cultists, and knew very little about their workings or whereabouts. But at the very least, we've...
merely doing his job. At
the very least, we've now acquired 3 very fine horses, as well as 10 days' worth of food for them, for each of them.
And, Octavia and Kate, if you both want to roll me insight checks.
Things just got out of hand.
Okay. You guys are in total agreement with Aravan's assessment of the situation.
Were you able to find anything out back around by the stables?
You say that he's not working with the cultists, but we saw him make a deal with a half-blue dragon.
Yeah, what was that? Merchant, I saw a merchant make a sale, it would seem. Little more than that. But
Nua said that he was killed.
What?
It was the same blue dragon we killed in the cave.
No, we left the merchant very much alive.
No, the blue dragon. There's a blue dragon. I thought
he said he was black.
No, Cyanrath. He was blue.
I know.
Oh, this is great. In character, nobody knows what the hell is going on.
Octavia, you rode off with the guy we killed at the cultist cave.
Numa, that was us.
That was Aravan and Cadence.
We just can't take you anywhere.
Me anywhere?
Numa, what were you able to find out?
I was able to find out that anytime we go out for just innocent recon, we end up stealing horses, killing people.
Stealing? We paid for them in full.
You just think
I didn't kill anyone.
Aside from rousing the man from his slumber, we did little more than perhaps scare the wits out of him. But in doing so, I can assure you he gave up all the information he had.
Believe me, everything you did tonight killed just a little bit of your soul.
Mayhaps, but we did learn that one of their names was Timur Zoss. He signed for the horses.
And I'll show them my receipt paper.
And additionally, in my
at
own
least
guise,
we got something out of it.
In my own guise of the half dragon, the horses didn't seem to have any sort of similar reaction to what I saw earlier when the rider from the palanquin mounted one of the horses. They reacted. Did not seem
I just thought
like
you were very well with animals.
So,
Chesco,
sensed something.
Whoever has access to Chesco, make me an animal handling check. Or anybody can make me a nature check.
Oh, do not want that.
I don't have access.
That guy.
Okay.
I meant to click something else.
Now you should have access to Chesco.
And then just go. Maybe. Can I not have 2 character sheets open?
I
also don't know.
I can do it. So can you.
So I can have like 10 open, but.
Jeez.
But you're special.
I can't.
But I am special.
It, so I must have not selected the character. So,
I'll make.
Ben, what do you know about nature?
I'll make a nature check for Jesco.
You paid for those horses?
In full. Well, at an agreed upon price.
And Jesco kind of perks up and he says, you said they didn't react to you, but they did to whoever the rider was before.
Yes.
Well, as Chip goes bye-bye.
He didn't want to know.
I've often seen horses shy at the scent of a predator.
Oh, hello.
It's like wolves or bears. They pick up the scent, they can often become unruly. Perhaps that's the difference. You may have looked like a blue dragon, but you didn't smell like one.
Perhaps you're right. The beasts could detect something I could not.
Should we make him smell like a blue dragon for next time?
No, I think what Chesco is saying, that it's not reacting to the sight, it's reacting to the presence of a dragon.
Octavia, I do not hope that for there to be a next time. We've got the horses.
Speaking of that, Xavier will flip his dagger around and resheath it and pull out the coin purse. And, Erevan, I believe this belongs to you.
So the merchant said he did not see a blue dragon before, but the horses reacted as if maybe there was a blue dragon. So are we saying the blue dragon guys are now looking like humans?
It's possible. Like I said, I wasn't able to catch a glimpse of their faces as they rode by.
If he can turn into a blue dragon, I don't see why blue dragons can't turn into humans.
But it's also possible he wore no such disguise at all, and it was just simply dark out.
If I remember right, the last time I saw him, he was cloaked, right? The black dragon guy?
Yes.
Okay. When I saw the black dragon guy, he was just cloaked.
No. Heavy dark robes?
Possibly, yes.
That is what I saw, an individual wearing heavy dark robes.
I think it's the same person. Or thing.
It's possible for him to have spooked the horses and such.
So are you taking the gold, Erevan?
Yeah. And Erevan would like to look Xavier up and down and kind of look at the gold and ask him what this is for.
Apparently, when the blue half-dragon made the deal with the merchant, I thought that the merchant was working with the cult. So I figured I would stop their funding, and I took it from him. Apparently, that blue half-dragon was you. So that's your gold.
So he stole these horses?
No, you paid for them. I stole the money. But at the time,
very well,
I thought I was taking from the cultist. In my defense.
I appreciate the thought, not so much the action, I suppose.
You threatened a man with a giant sword, so I don't want to hear any reprimand from you, Erevan.
We are such a nuisance to civility.
Numa regrets ever going.
Starting to look pretty good, Numa.
When this is over, I'm going back to my cloister.
Menace to society.
There's our party name.
Oh my god. M2S, yes. I have to look for the Latin of menace to society.
Okay.
Things got out of hand. I took gold. Some things got out of hand, yeah.
It is now a little after 10.
Oh, that's a good place to stop.
Once again, this session went somewhere I totally did not expect.
This is awesome, guys.
Which it really is. I am having much fun with just the I never know what's going to happen. Seeing our paladin turn into a blue half-dragon and berate a poor merchant. I mean, that's just...
That guy got the shit out of the deal tonight, man.
He had a rough night. I feel really bad for him.
He doesn't have a receipt to take it to lost claims, you know, lost items. And
I hope he has
his gold is gone, his horses are gone. This guy just got screwed.
So... I guess
Numa's going to start writing a letter to that poor guy.
Did you finish the one to Leo?
Did you ever finish your last letter?
I think Numa's so. I think we had plenty. Yeah, we had plenty of time last week for me to finish a letter while the other two were dying in an alley.
I mean, I think technically we started off this session saying that you were still writing that letter because you didn't really understand the cipher, and so you kept messing up the cipher, and so you had to start over.
Awesome, yeah.
So at this point,
you can't write letters of apology fast enough.
I'm
about to pull that letter back out to Leos and saying. And what were you thinking putting me with this group of misfits?
Make sure you
know. Is this a test, Master? Is this a test?
There's some black dragon guy.
Am I on
now leaving to the north?
Maybe he thought you could be a guiding light for them.
Yeah, but the monk's about to get some tattoos.
Uh oh.
Yeah. Thug life.
That's right. Thug life.
Yeah, that's exactly. Thug life right across here. You know.
Yeah. In an elemental font.
Oh okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, you can get it in Ignan.
There you go.
It's a great language, okay?
Oh. Anyway. So, any highlights from the night? Any inspiration that wishes to be given?
I think Aravan deserves inspiration for thinking of turning into that dragonborn and using it as a, hey, you sold our horses, where the fuck are they? Like, I was just gonna
that was a pretty good move.
Yeah, like...
Although that ultimately it didn't really pan out with anything, but it was a pretty good move.
No, by I had the very least.
What are you talking about?
We got three. We stole from an innocent guy. Three.
We steal from innocent people. We're looking for cultists. Maybe we are the cultists.
We are turning people into what we are hunting.
Guys, I never left the cult.
I never left.
Yes.
So basically,
that's a good point.
You have become the party of thieving murder hobos.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
But with good intentions.
Both of those. Were...
You know what they say about good intentions.
Yeah. Okay. First of all, we killed four people in self-defense. Secondly, I'll take it. I took it from.
We stole horses.
No, you guys paid for horses. You guys are in the clear. I just stole money. That's all. I'll take that.
All right. So we can all agree that Xavier, who owes that guy 300 gold.
No.
You know they hang people around here for stealing horses.
I will not be putting my armor on until we leave.
Numa, be sure to include his full name in that.
Speak of him as the rogue.
So what was his full name? Xavier, I did it all. It's all my fault. I stole from them.
And murdered those
Shadow
guys.
Leaf.
And murdered those guys. I think Chesco actually took out, like, three of them, so...
Of course he did.
You weren't there. You don't know.
I mean, you told us about the 12 people you killed, so that's what Numa's telling him about.
So,
there's 12 bodies.
We went into a town and killed 12 people.
Yeah.
So what do you guys want to do next week? What do you hope to accomplish?
Guard a caravan.
Not getting caught by this person?
Guard a caravan.
You know, Chip, maybe if that's your goal, maybe you should have Numa speak up a little more about maybe we should just try to guard a caravan.
It is just like a car wreck. It's like you want to look away. You want to say, watch out. But you just want to see where it goes. Because I almost created more mischief by rushing out of the stable saying, Aravan, you won't believe what we found in the loft. But I thought that would be too much. That would be too much.
Numa's the person that's like driving on the highway and there's an accident and he's like, God, there's an accident. There better be a body.
Yeah. It's just like, where are they going to go with this? So yeah, it's almost somewhat like shocking, like, I'm not doing to say a thing yet. Just going to see where it goes.
Well, maybe it can.
But yeah, Numa is going to write a letter with his real feelings in it and then tear that letter up.
Okay.
Next week and for me.
Aravan.
So, Aravan, Ryan's highlight was definitely as soon as he knocked on that front door, because I was like, okay, gonna be this Dragonborn guy, so the guy can be like, oh, well, we were supposed to sell it to Dragonborns, and maybe we'll get some more information if he thinks we're cultists, or if he's like, oh, we gave it to the wrong Dragonborn, those guys said they were headed X and X place, or something, but no, he was just an innocent guy who didn't know anything.
No, it was a great concept. I do. I mean, really, honestly, I thought, man, that is a bold move. That's going to work.
Because of the perceived benefit as well as the like serious time crunch due to the ult only having an hour to find these guys with his spell up, that's kind of the way that he went about justifying going a little dark on this guy because the information now.
And it's great because I mean, it surprised me, but I could totally see what you were trying to do.
Brilliant.
I mean, I guess if I'd been more quick thinking, maybe I would have played along with it. But in my head, this guy was just what you saw. He just had sold 3 horses that were going to be picked up at this time. You know.
And that's eventually why he was totally okay with just giving this guy his money. He didn't have the 300, which was ultimately why he went to negotiate at the end there.
So, you know, third party looking at this, this sounds awfully familiar to last week. Francesco was like, I'm praising a giant dragon demon lady.
A whole lot less bodies this time.
We didn't kill anyone.
Yeah, nobody died.
Well,
but I mean,
things from, get a little out of hand.
Again, from the I kind of have an idea of who knows what, who doesn't, and how this is going down, and like the sheer commitment that you guys have, and the conviction you have, in basically saying, "Aha, I know that person knows something," and I'm like, that person has no idea what you're talking about. But you guys are just so sure.
This is like the worst case of detectives ever.
I saw him buy something from that vending machine. That vending machine was clearly in on it.
Yeah, y'all like the what was that group on the X-Files? Those three guys who were always with the conspiracy theorists. I can't remember their names. Remember those guys?
I was thinking more like Inspector Clouseau.
Well, yeah, with a bit of Clouseau in there. That's a good point.
I mean, there's a lot of
by accident.
I just saw you. You just picked this up. Therefore, you're the guilty party. As the thief is like walking behind him down the road. You know?
Yeah, by accident, we're going to solve all of this.
Gives the money back to the thief. I am so sorry, sir.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. You dropped this, please. I wouldn't want you to leave Paris thinking we're all like this. Here, take this with you. All right.
We'll get there. Amanda. We'll get there.
Yeah, Amanda.
Oh man. Well, next week, maybe we'll eat some more ham.
How actually, are you still working on
it? It just occurs
after you finished.
A new okay, ham. So, a new ham.
So next what? Week is the 20th.
It's the yes, 20th. Okay. Sorry.
I will still be at home, so I will still be capable of DMing. But I have no idea what like family holiday plans are going to be like and all that kind of stuff for you guys. So we kind of.
I think I should be fine.
Tuesday, next Tuesday's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm free.
The Tuesday after, I will almost certainly be out of town and will be staying at a place that probably does not have internet. So I will probably be unable to do anything on the week of the 27th.
So that's when we can just assume that all these people we've murdered finally pays off. On the 27th, and they give us all the information.
So yes, all those people you've murdered will be discovered, and the police will go on a manhunt.
That's, for cultists, yeah. Of course.
For cultists, yes.
Yeah, we need anyway, to get out of here.
Sorry, that I just thought of that all of a sudden. So, Octavia, you were saying about ham.
Yeah, no, but for real, next week, I think we just need to try and get the caravan moving. Like, we probably need to get out of this place before any of us are recognized for any of the terrible deeds we've done.
Before our luck runs out.
I'm just very sympathetic with the citizens of this city, and it would just be in our best their best interest if we just left.
I completely understand. The guards are very justified in their hearts.
Before someone gives Aravan a weird look, and the next thing you know, we're following them home and stalking their family.
I mean, I think at the very end there, I think it was Numa giving me the weird look.
And finally, Lucas.
Yes. Well, I'm going to say my highlight was playing up to my character's chaotic good nature and trying to Robin Hood that shit away from the so-called cultist horse dealer.
And then you're like, oh, I totally robbed
from you. From your perspective, I had no problem with that. I was like, yep, he just saw the guy make a deal with a half-dragon that he doesn't know is Aravan.
Yep. I was like, you ain't taking that gold.
That's exactly what should happen.
Yep. And if they didn't come out to the back, I was totally planning on interrogating the stable boy to find out information about the rider of the horse to see if they knew, because they looked at it when they brought the horses out. So, but yeah, that was my highlight for that one for sure. Next week, one more shenanigans and, you know, third time's the charm, and hopefully we don't get caught.
Technically, if you remember, the way it went was the palanquin came up, the two carriers went to the door,
yeah, got the horses and came
and back. Then went around the back and got the horses.
Oh, that's right.
And brought it back out to the palanquin.
Well, I almost had two more bodies on my hand. So,
so
good
next
thing
week,
we intervened.
Yeah.
We see if we get three strikes and we go out or what. I mean,
you're allowed four bodies in one city, right? I mean,
that's
a thing, right?
You already have four.
I think that's our quota.
That's our quota,
just
right?
As long as it's different area codes.
Right,
that's
right.
The key.
I can kill someone.
One's inside the gate, one's outside.
What happens in Baldur's Gate stays in Baldur's Gate.
Except when it doesn't.
I'm sure Evan would probably get his hat back from Caden, though, when we get back. Just saying.
Once we leave, yeah.
Okay. Don't want to forget that precious gem.
Alright, guys. Well, again, excellent session, and this has been more fun than I thought it would be.
Oh, it's interesting.
The guys, watch it.
Great job with all the antics out of left field that we were throwing. Yeah.
Hey, that's exactly the kind of, like, I want you guys to roleplay, and these are great roleplaying opportunities. This is... Like, I'm perfectly happy that it was only because we went down a rabbit hole of an RP event that we even had the last combat.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
I mean, ideally, you don't want any combat in this city. F-20 guards.
And yes, the guards will be on the lookout for that kind of stuff. So, yeah, they would have.
All right.
Thanks, Ben. Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Yeah.
Have a good night.
Great session.
Bye.
See you guys next week.
Bye-bye.